Years ago, there was a popular song that went like this. You've got to accentuate the positive, eliminate the negative, latch on to the affirmative, and don't mess with Mr. In-Between. Surely many in the modern church have taken this philosophy very much to heart. Negativity has become so feared and despised and shunned in many pulpits that you could attend these churches for years without learning there was such a place as hell or discovering that God ever became angry. If hearing anything negative was in truth harmful for us, we would expect that the Bible would be 100% positive, with no talk of sin or judgment or hell or pain or suffering. But what kind of Bible would that be? There is a positive, tender, and very sweet side to our compassionate Creator, to be sure, but it is not His only side. The God who is love is also called a jealous God and a consuming fire. People who only want to hear of God's compassion but have no use for His holiness and His hatred for sin are like children who want cotton candy for breakfast, chocolate cake for lunch, and a plateful of donuts for dinner. Such a diet would be very sweet and might satisfy us for a time, but it would eventually kill us. Jesus was in many respects a very positive person. He spoke of a heavenly Father who loves us and values us and will provide for all our needs. He gave hope to the suffering, mercy to the sinners, and friendship to the friendless. It would be possible to preach and write only about these positive aspects of the life and ministry of Jesus and give the impression that He never became angry, never spoke of judgment. But that would be simply untrue. There is another side of Jesus we find in the Gospels that is just as valid and just as much truly Jesus as these positive aspects of our Savior. Jesus was not afraid to speak of hell and to encourage us in the most graphic of all language to avoid it at all costs. He declared, "Do not fear those who kill the body, but cannot kill the soul, but rather fear Him who is able to destroy both soul and body in hell." Jesus spoke more about hell than any other person in the Bible. Warnings sound so negative, they just don't feel as good as a compliment or a congratulation. Warnings tell us we're going the wrong direction, that disaster is ahead. But of course, there's nothing the least bit unloving about a warning. Indeed, it would be unloving not to warn had we certain knowledge of calamity that lay ahead in someone's path. Since the Bible is obviously utterly fearless in accentuating both the positive and the negative, why is it these things are virtually ignored in so many churches today? First, many pastors and teachers think they're doing God a favor by hiding what they perceive as His negative aspects and focusing only upon His positive ones. Their idea is, if I preach only about God's love and kindness, I'll attract more people to Him. That may sound reasonable, but giving people a partial picture of God is never healthy. Paul wrote, "I have not shunned to declare unto you the whole counsel of God." The Bible says, consider the goodness and the severity of God. A second and sadder reason that the entirety of God's nature is not being proclaimed is that many church leaders simply don't read the Bible enough to even realize that their emphasis is not biblically balanced. The cross of Jesus is a wonderful reminder of God's great love for us all, but it is also an awesome testimony to the holiness and the perfection of our God. Sin is too terrible, and God is too holy to merely sweep aside all of our lies and blasphemies and fornications. A price must be paid. The justice of God must be satisfied. Hence the cross, the bloody nails, and the terrible scourging that shredded the back of our Savior. Certainly, we must proclaim the love of God poured out on us through Jesus Christ, but we must also preach repentance from sin. Coming to Jesus just as I am does not mean coming to Jesus fully determined to go on with our wicked, lawless lifestyle. Let our triune God be declared in all His fullness, tender-hearted and compassionate toward His stumbling, erring creation, and yet resplendent in His dazzling perfection and holiness. Let pastors do away with their jelly donut sermons and begin to feed their congregations with the full knowledge of God, and men and women will be drawn unto Him.